Cause the boys in the hood are always hard. You come talking that trash, we'll pull your car. Knowing nothing in life but to be legit. Don't quote me, boy, cause I ain't said shit.
Hello. Today I will be comparing Boys in the Hood, a film directed by John Singleton, to Code of the Street, a book by Elijah Anderson. Anderson placed himself in an inner-city neighborhood for 4 years in order to facilitate the research needed for his book. What he found was pretty interesting. There were two types of families that were produced in the same living environment. One he referred to as street, and the other he referred to as decent. A few features of street families range from being loud, materialistic, violent, may dabble in drugs or be full-on drug dealers, lack trust and authority, and do not supervise their children. The youth that they raise tend to grow up looking for and craving respect, and will fight or kill another person at any moment in order to gain respect from anyone around observing, since respect is a currency that is easily lost. In contrast to that, the characteristics of decent families are almost a complete 180. They cooperate with laws, trust authoritative figures, and do not actively try to cause trouble. They place a larger emphasis on school and encourage their children to do the same. They actively supervise them to make sure they are not causing any trouble themselves. Their children do not feel the same craving for respect, and in most cases, will not kill or fight in order to prove themselves. This is a scene from Boys in the Hood that illustrates the concept of street versus decent.
Hey man, what's wrong with you? Fuck you looking at, nigga? I'm still trying to find out, nigga!
Hold on. Oh, we got a problem here?
Oh, what up with this?
Run away, nigga.
Can we have one night where there ain't no fight and nobody gets shot?
Shut up, bitch.
Bitch, I will fuck
you. Call a bitch.
Let's get that bitch ass.
Why are you like that?
This is Ricky, who comes from a decent household. As you can tell from his reaction of being shoved into the car, he is not used to physical confrontations being used in order to gain respect. He was not looking for trouble whatsoever, but feels his inner sense of bravado threatened by this thug. He uses his words initially instead of immediately retaliating through physical means, a quality that decent people usually have. On the other hand, this is Doughboy. He did not learn the decent values that his brother Ricky absorbed, which is apparent through his reaction to the thug's physicality towards Ricky. He knows how to get respect and how to assert dominance, and does so by showing and cocking the pistol on his waist. The thug and his entourage have no choice but to respect the gun and bow out of the situation. Doughboy's street smarts are on display here, and save them from a potentially sticky situation. This baby looks a little confused, and I don't blame her. The burning question that hasn't been answered still remains. How can one living environment produce two different cultures? Well, let's focus on the street aspect first. The people who adhere to the code of the street and commit crime, sell drugs, and murder others aren't born with these types of instincts. In fact, they're not bad people at all. Their actions are responses to their living environments, and their thought process when committing crimes is based on the context of their own situation. To live in dilapidated buildings with physical decay everywhere, subpar schooling and low-paying jobs gets under the skin of people who are forced to occupy the space. Anderson states, people frequently have a limited understanding of priorities and consequences, and so frustration mounts over bills, food, and at times, liquor, cigarettes, and drugs. On top of this, those who come from tough financial situations may often see upper-class individuals with well-paying jobs, which cause them to take a look at their own situation and become, well, angry. This anger doesn't sit well, which causes them to reject the values of the upper or middle class to whom these highly paid individuals belong to, which includes obeying the law. They act in contempt of these laws and are more likely to be a repeat offender because they simply do not care to act any different. As previously stated, they aren't bad people, just frustrated beyond belief and acting out in an attempt to better their own situation. Decent families tend not to cause any crime based on the fact that their situation does not push them to feel the need to. A stronger sense of family comes with them because they are more likely to have two parental roles in the household instead of a single one. With a larger focus on education compared to the street families, they may have netted better paying jobs, which in turn gets them a nicer house and more resources to work with. They don't feel this frustration over simple things such as bills, and in turn accept standard middle class values, which guides their choices. They pass these values on to their children, which leads to a much smaller chance of them turning to criminal activities and paving a successful future outside of the inner city street that they were raised on. You could have guessed that decent families raise children who are regarded as nerds and get picked on by the street kids because they are different. Well, this is where a concept that Anderson calls code switching comes into play. Take a look.
My daddy says that makes the place where all people originated from. That means everybody's really from Africa. Everybody. All y'all. Everybody.
I ain't from Africa. I'm from Crenshaw Mafia.
Like it or not, you from Africa.
I'm from Africa. You from Africa, you African booty scratcher.
Look, I'll kick your ass.
Okay, boys, that's enough. Count to 10 and be quiet.
I'll get my brother and shoot you in the face.
Get your punk ass brother,
Trey.
Bitch. I get my daddy. At least I got one, motherfucker.
Well, that escalated quickly. Upon first look, Trey's a well-dressed child jokingly instructing the class, but he's actually doing pretty well. He's from a decent background, and it's apparent from his appearance and by the clear articulation that is of his words that he was raised right. That is, until this young boy makes him upset. He rapidly code switches from decent to street and speaks a language that is used by those who run the streets in order to show the boy he isn't a punk and to get respect. Anderson describes code switching as an effective way to deter bullying from happening and to make sure future harassment does not occur as often. He uses a few examples of decent families encouraging their children to defend themselves by utilizing this skill, and even street families do the same. By either using strong words or physical action, a certain level of respect comes from code switching. Respect is what the code of the street is all about. It's earned every day at various venues that Anderson calls staging areas. Those areas can really be anywhere. A school, a mall, the beach, anywhere that people are around and where you can prove that you deserve to be respected. Doughboy and Ricky embarrassed the thug in the earlier film clip in front of a large amount of people, so naturally the thug felt compelled to earn that respect back, and as Anderson describes, there's only a few ways you get that back. The main one is being violent.
Ricky!
The thug and his entourage showed that they were to be respected, because if they were crossed, it would place a target on the back of whomever did it. Now, Doughboy did not take kindly to his brother being murdered, and obeyed the code of the street by getting revenge on Ricky's attacker. There's a few reasons, according to Anderson, that Doughboy would do this. One is because this was a personal battle, because he was a blood relative. And two, if he did not act, this would destroy his street reputation and make him look like a punk for not acting out in response.
Fuck you, man! Fuck you! Turn your punk ass off! What man, I didn't do it, man! I didn't pull the fucking trigger! What the fuck you doing? Oh, man. Well, fuck you!
If it seems that street characters go extremely far to get respect, then you're correct in that assumption. It governs just about every interaction that happens in the hood and has engraved itself into the culture. The culture is followed every day, and those who adhere to the code of the street eat, sleep, and breathe it, which creates the implication of committing any crime imaginable in order to gain respect, since it is the only thing in life worth striving for. These people are stuck in a rut of criminality with no clear way to escape it. In conclusion, Elijah Anderson's theory is clearly applicable to the movie Boyz in the Hood and does a fantastic job of showing that inner city crime is not about bad people doing bad things because they're bad. It goes to show that adverse reactions to their living conditions fester themselves physically in the way of crime being committed. It's important to understanding why crime rates are higher in socially disorganized neighborhoods, especially in inner city settings.
Started thinking, man. Either they don't know, don't show, or don't care about what's going on in the hood.
That's all, folks. Next time, we'll be talking about elevated crime in the city.
And yo, remember Black, it's time. Word, it's time, man. It's time, man. Alright, begin. Yeah, straight out the fucking dungeons of rap, where fake niggas don't make it back. I don't know how to start this. Yo. Yeah. Rap
rappers are monkey flipping with the funky rhythm. I be kicking, musician, inflicting composition of pain. I'm like Scarface sniffing cocaine.